Well, hello everybody. Welcome to our class today. Today's class is going to be about pitching and putting. But before we get to that important topic, I want to do two really fantastic shout outs. I want to start our shout out this week to Golf Town's brand ambassador, Brooke Henderson. So for any Canadian out there, if you haven't heard this news, this is fantastic news. This past weekend, Brooke Henderson won her 10th LPGA title at the age of 23. Brooke Henderson is truly as sweet and as kind as she appears to be on TV or perhaps on social media. I've had the opportunity to meet her several times and she is truly delightful and a treasure of Canada. So I know so many people were cheering her on and she is the winningest Canadian on both the PGA Tour or LPGA Tour, male or female, of any Canadian. So I think the sky's the limit for Brooke, and huge shout out and congratulations to Brooke because we are all just so proud of you, Brooke. So proud of you. I see I have some people joining us this morning. I've got this evening. Laura, hello, and Matthew, thanks so much for joining us. Mark, Andre, I see you're tagging friends. That's awesome. Please tag and share with friends. And Chris, you're a Special Olympics athlete from London, Ontario. Woo-woo! I love Special Olympics. I actually just filmed a video from our Special Olympic athletes in Alberta yesterday. So thanks for joining us today, Chris. This is perfect. All right, my second shout-out today goes to the unsung heroes of the golf industry. And who are the unsung heroes of the golf industry? Golf superintendents. If you know a golf superintendent, you know how hard they work. At the wee hours in the morning that they get up to prepare the golf courses for us so that we have these absolutely gorgeous, pristine courses, beautiful greens that are rolling, fantastically mowed fairways and rough, and they truly make our golf experience what it is. And of course, right now, think about in Ontario, a big, huge shout out to all our friends in Ontario. I know your courses aren't opened up. And again, we're wishing for that to happen for you very soon. But think about all the superintendents who are so dedicated to their craft, maintaining these golf courses while nobody's playing. And of course, that happened last year throughout the pandemic when all those courses shut. Golf superintendents throughout the world kept those courses in pristine condition, getting it ready for when you were ready to come back to the course, which was pretty darn cool. And if you think about how tough their job is, I live in Alberta. In the last 3 weeks, we've had days that were 20 degrees Celsius on one day, golfing, amazing. Next day, 3 degrees and snowing. And I don't know how they managed to keep those greens and everything beautiful with those massive sways in temperature, but they do. And I had an opportunity to speak to the British Columbia Golf Superintendents Association this past November. Incredible people. So the next time you are at a golf course that you like to play at, please search out your superintendent. Thank your superintendents and groundskeepers for everything they do to make our rounds enjoyable. So another big shout out. I see Laverne from Calgary. Hey, I'm a born and raised Calgarian. Woo woo. And Mei Chung, thank you. So appreciate that you love the enthusiasm. And Angela, oh, my hummingbirds. You noticed my hummingbirds. I thought it's spring. I got to bring out some hummingbirds, right? Very fun, very fun. All right. Well, we got to get down to business today because we got lots to cover. Originally, I was just going to cover putting today. But last week when I did chipping, I was so thrilled with all the comments that I received. But I had many people say, Lisa, do you use the flamingo in pitching as well when you're far away from the green? Or how far away from the green do you use the flamingo? So let's sort that out right now. First of all, for all of you that love the flamingo, I was so happy to see so many people. Lisa, I chipped in for the first time. I had a lady reach out to me. Lisa, my husband shot 78 using your tips with the flamingo. He said, please, thank you. So awesome, awesome, awesome that the flamingo is working. But people were wondering, what's the difference? So the difference between chipping and pitching. Chipping typically happens, let's call it maybe 15 feet, 3 paces off the green, ballpark. So it happens very close to the green. And typically in chipping, the ball is going to run a longer way. So that's what your chipping is. What is pitching? Pitching is the ball is going to travel higher up and not roll out as far. So that's kind of the difference between pitching and chipping. For pitching, you might have to pitch over a bunker if you're just off the green and you have to pitch over a bunker. Perhaps it's a pond. Maybe you're 50, 60, 40 yards out from the green and you don't want to putt that far and that's too risky to chip it that far because you don't know how the ground condition is going to deal with your ball chipping. So that's when you would pitch. So I will teach you about pitching today, and then we'll go into our putting after that. I just want to say another hello today. I see Susan. Oh, that you love the flamingo. You've been trying that out this last week. That's fantastic. And Helen from Ottawa. She's excited about today's tip, so that's great. Okay, so what is pitching? So we just explained what pitching is. How do we start with our pitching? First thing is I want to talk about is club selection. So your club for selection for pitching, you want to use something that's very high lofted. Now, of course, most of us have a pitching wedge in our bag. peg, but that's not the most high lofted club you might have. I want you to try pitching with, if you have a lob wedge, which is a 60 degree wedge, or a sand wedge, which is typically about a 56 degree wedge, 56, maybe 58 degree wedge. So take a peek at the other wedges that you have in your bag, in your arsenal, to try this out, because you want a nice high lofted club. And can you use your pitching wedge? Absolutely. But again, a nice high lofted club is going to make this pitch shot much easier for you. So that's step number one. Step number two, you do not use the flamingo stance. You do not use the flamingo stance. What you're going to do is, for alignment, we're going to have the ball position in the same, because we want to have a consistent ball position there. Remember, we talked about ball position being the exact same for every club in your bag except for driver. So you're going to start with your feet together where you eyeball the ball in the middle of your feet. You're going to move your lead foot about the width of a club head. Now here's the key with the ball position in pitching: very, very narrow stance. You have a very, very narrow stance. So it almost looks like that ball is maybe even in the middle of your stance. That's what it almost looks like, but it's definitely too, you know, kind of that width of the club head off the lead foot. Very, very narrow stance though, okay? So that's the first step there. The next key for pitching, you are going to have a little bit of weight on that front side. So my coach Paul Horton said the shorter the chip, shorter the pitch, you might have more weight. So maybe it's like 75-80% on that lead foot if it's a short pitch. Maybe it's about 55-60% of the weight on that lead foot if it's a longer pitch, okay? But definitely weight on the front side. Definitely weight on the front side. That's important for your setup, okay? So it's feet together, width of a club head away, very, very narrow stance. Put a little bit of that weight on that front side. The next part that we need to do with our pitching is you need to think about pivoting around your front leg. Pivoting around your front leg. That's the key that my coach Paul Horton said is the key to really hitting great pitch shots. It's a little mini swing. So it's not a putting stroke like we did in the flamingo. It's not just that shoulder rock. You're actually pivoting around that front leg. It's a baby swing. It's a baby swing. And then what you want to do is you want to make sure you brush the grass. That is so key. And you know, if you've watched any of my videos, that's one of my three top tips that you have to leave with, and that is brush the grass. So when you brush that grass, again, let's take a peek here. Again, when you brush that grass, let's do it without a ball first. You've got to have that little bit of weight there. You want to do the practice swings. This is where the practice swings are going to be key, because you want to make sure you're brushing the grass. And again, pivoting around that lead foot, and you want to actually almost get that chest facing at least to the target, maybe even past the target, okay? The next tip I'm going to give you for good pitching is you want to do something that's measurable. So I like the idea of measurable in a golf swing, because that's how we can work on setting a standard and how we can improve and what works and what doesn't work. So when I say something measurable, when I'm pitching, I like to think I want to go maybe start with a short pitch. I might go ankle to ankle height. So I'm going to take it back as far as I take it through. And again, my coach Paul Horton said one of the biggest mistakes that he sees from amateur golfers that are not good at pitching is they end up taking way too big of a backswing. So if you take way too big of a backswing and you realize you only have 40 yards that you need to make this shot travel, what happens is you take this huge backswing and then you kind of chunk down and you shorten that follow through and you have no distance control, zero distance control. So he said the worst thing you can do is take a big backswing. You want your follow through and your backswing to be ballpark about the same distance. So again, that's what I love: ankle to ankle, knee to knee, hip to hip. Something that's very measurable. Now, my coach likes to think of it as a clock. I like body parts. He likes a clock. So he likes to think 9 to 3. You know, he likes to think maybe it's going to be 5 to 7. So whatever it is, he likes to think of it as a clock, and I like to think of it as body parts. But whatever it is, think of something measurable for pitching, okay? So let's go through this one more time. We're going to use a high lofted club, maybe a 60 degree wedge, sand wedge, potentially a pitching wedge. Once you have that club, what you want to do is you want to go feet together, move the lead foot about the width of a club head from the middle of your stance. Very, very narrow stance. Weight on that front leg, okay? We're going to brush the grass and we're going to do a baby stroke. I'm going to kind of go calf to calf on this one. Brush the grass and pivot around that lead foot. There we go. And it was right on target. So again, this is something you need to practice. Put in some time. And I know golf courses are closed in Ontario, and in other parts of Canada where it's too snowy right now. But if your courses are open, make sure you spend some time at the range practicing this shot. This is a really important shot. So because we always get so nervous of that 40, 50, 60 yard shot into the green. How do we do it? Well, that's called pitching. And this is how you do it. So hopefully those tips helped you. I want to do a shout out to see Pat, that you're loving the tips. That's awesome. Thanks so much. Lori, good for you viewed here, body parts. I like body parts too, because it's something I can see physically and measure it. So I'm a body part person too. And Chris, awesome. Thanks so much for your kind words. Super appreciate that, Chris. All right, let's get into putting. Now putting, this is, in my opinion, the fastest way to drop your scores in golf. Become a really good putter, all right? So let's talk about putting. I'm gonna get rid of my mat here, just a sec. Get rid of my mat so that we can focus all on putting. First thing we want to talk about putting is, I'm going to talk about equipment. There are so many different kinds of putters. And I think that some of us, if we started as a kid, like let's say many of us started as a kid with kind of like a blade kind of putter, a blade or a style putter here. So you stuck with that. Have you tried other types of putters? Have you tried a mallet putter? Just a sec. Have you tried a mallet style putter? So again, don't just stick with what you've always used. Putting is really, really personal. So you've got to try some of the new stuff. Maybe you like the blade, but this one's called like a double wide. This one's called a double wide. Check that out. So maybe there's different styles of the blade. Also, you can start to see really cool different styles of putters out there that kind of mimic a mallet and kind of try to, there's different ones like face balances and toe hangs. And of course, there's also really cool different alignment ones as well. So this one is called the two ball, and it also uses what we call triple track technology. So you have the alignment lines and the visual of the two ball, really popular one on tour. So that's kind of cool. So first thing out there, make sure you try different equipment. That's number one, okay? Now, so with the equipment, I showed you lots of different types of putters that are out there. And again, I recommend you go to your local golf town when it's open, of course, staying social distance. They have hundreds of putters for you to try for free. Spend a couple hours there. Practice your putting. See what you love and find a putter that you love and that loves you as well. The next part of your equipment, your grip. This could be the best $35 you spend this season on your golf game, okay? We're going to talk a little bit later about one of the cardinal sins of pitching. Of putting, and that is breaking your wrists. You never, ever, 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 never want to break your wrists in putting. And so one of the ways that can stop that is a thicker grip. And there's many different grips. So you can get a grip that's kind of like a triangle style here that helps you keep those wrists quiet. You can kind of get a medium size grip that again helps stabilize those wrists. I actually kind of like, I prefer a bigger grip. And again, this bigger grip just helps me quiet my hands. So if you're someone who's using one of the old style grips, and that's okay. If that's a grip that works for you, that's cool too. But one of those really skinny, narrow ones, maybe that's allowing you to move your wrists too much. And that's an easy, where the fitter at Golf Town or wherever can take off that grip and you can pop on a new grip and it's about $35, okay? Now, this next tip is for my ladies out there, and you know, some men too, but I really find this with my ladies, this can be a game changer. Often for women, I know for myself, is we get hand-me-down putters, which is great. I got a hand-me-down putter from my dad. Well, my dad's 6'2". I'm 5'6¾". So, you know, there's a little bit of a height discrepancy there. But we all shouldn't be using the same size of putter. The key for putting is you want to get your eyes over top of your ball. And to do that, you have to have a putter that fits you. So again, often ladies who get a hand-me-down putter from their dad, their brother, perhaps a friend, a spouse, that they might be using the wrong size putter. So again, it's a quick and inexpensive fix to have your grip pulled off. Often they can save that grip. Then they can cut the shaft down, put the grip back on, or you might have to purchase a grip. So again, maybe $30 or something. And boom, now your eyes are over your ball and you are sinking way more putts. So I highly recommend take your putter in and get it fitted with a professional fitter, and you can do that at Golf Town as well. Okay, now we've talked about the equipment itself and how that's really important. Now let's talk about fundamentals of putting. So fundamentals of putting, number one, we want to talk about is getting the eye over the ball. So when you're putting, it is really important, here we go, it's really important that when you're putting that you get that eye, just a sec, let me see if you can see that ball here. Just a sec, can you see that there? Okay, but when you're putting, we wanna see that eye over the ball, okay? If your putter's too long, you're gonna be away, your eyes are not gonna be over the ball. You wanna have the eyes right over the golf ball. What's a way that you can check to see if the eyes are over your golf ball? Here's a cool little drill. What I want you to do is I want you to take a golf ball, hold it at your eye, and then I want you to drop it down, and if it lands on the golf ball, your eyes are over the ball. So set up to your ball. Here we go. Set up to your ball, put the ball over your eye and drop it. boom, it hit the ball. So my eyes were over the ball. So that's a great way to see if your eyes are over the ball. Now my coach, Paul Horton, who of course is a PGA of Canada professional, and you know, every video I tell you, please go see your PGA Tour, LPGA Tour, or PGA of America instructor, wherever your professional instructors are, to help you with your golf swing, of course. But my PGA pro, that he said some golfers prefer to have their eyes slightly inside, but most golfers like to have their eyes over their ball, okay? So that's really important to get those eyes over that ball. And again, putter length is something that's going to help with that. So that's a really key fundamental. Now, what about ball position? Ball position for putter. Now, ball position for putter, this is not like full swing. So don't think about my normal alignment tip that I've given you. Putting is different. Putting's different. So a lot of people, when I see them putt, when I see them get ready to putt, I see them have their ball in the dead center of their stance. Dead center of their stance. The problem with having the ball in the dead center of your stance is it's hard to get it rolling that way. It's easier for the ball to skip and jump a little bit, and your whole purpose in putting is you want to get that ball rolling, rolling end over end, nice and smooth. And to do that, again, my coach Paul Horton said, you want to put that ball slightly ahead of forward, slightly ahead of forward, and perhaps that's about a ball width ahead of forward. So again, if your ball is in the center of your stance or at the back of your stance, that could be, we could fix you today. I want you to move that ball position just slightly ahead. So again, if I had my alignment stick here, let me show you. Here's my alignment stick. So you don't want that ball in the center of your stance. You want it to be slightly forward. So closer to your lead foot, closer to your lead foot. And that's going to help you roll a heck of a lot more putts. All right, David, I'm so thrilled that you love these videos. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Rita, thanks for tagging friends. I love it. And Heidi, oh, I too wish your Ontario golf courses would open as well. Awesome. Awesome. All right, next fundamental. So first of all, we talked about eyes over the ball and ball position. Next fundamental, and this one is imperative. If you want to be a good putter, you need to create a triangle. And the triangle is going to go shoulder to shoulder and down to your hands. Kind of like a prayer position here. Kind of like a prayer position. For proper putting, you want to create this triangle. And what makes your swing move and what makes you make a great putting stroke is you want to rock your shoulders. What I never ever want to see in putting, I see this sometimes, people swaying their body. If you sway your body, you're really going to struggle with putting. I also don't ever want to see you kind of twisting your body. Your whole body, kind of from your rib cage down, is still. Very, very still. That lower body, if you want to think that lower body, it's very still, because I guess your rib cage is going to move with your torso. So let's talk lower body. That lower body, as you can see here, all that's happening is I'm rocking my shoulders and my lower body is very, very quiet. You want to consider this nice triangle. You want to, again, just rocking those shoulders back and forth. A great little thought for that, because tempo and rhythm is really, really important in the golf swing. I want you to think tick, talk. For any of you that grew up playing piano lessons or any musical instruments, perhaps you had a metronome, your teacher had a metronome for you, that little clock that went tick, tock, tick, tock. That's how I want you to think in your putting stroke. I want you to think really, really smooth tempo, tick, tock. You can even say it to yourself as you're putting, tick, tock. And again, that's rocking the shoulders. You're just using your core to turn you there. Those shoulders, tick, talk, very, very little body movement down there. Again, really, really little body movement. So important to get that triangle going. That's really, really important to get that going. We've already talked about the importance of not getting those wrists. So that's where those grips can help you here. What's going to kill your distance control, if you start putting, and I'll make a putt here, if you start putting and you start cracking your wrists, you have no idea where this ball is going to go. So again, we never ever want to use our wrists in putting. It will kill your distance control. That's why you always want to make sure you have the triangle and of course a loose grip. You don't want that tight, no tension and no shoulders up here. So relaxed grip pressure. All right, another fault that I see all the time that I think I can fix so many of you today with this simple tip is I find a lot of people when they make a stroke, when they're making a putting stroke, what happens is they get excited to see their ball go in. So they get set up for the putting stroke, they go to watch their putt, and as they watch their putt, did you see how that back shoulder? Because when I go up to look, my back shoulder follows me. And what happens is as soon as you make that putt, and if you, I'm gonna use a blade to show you with this one actually, it'll be a little easier to see with a blade. If you, as soon as you make that putt, if you start to turn that shoulder, what happens is that putter face already starts to close. And what you'll start to miss putts all the time on that side of the cup. So really, really important is that we need to make sure that we don't look up too early. So this is a drill that Pia Nielsen from Vision 54 shared, and it was just a light bulb moment for me. So if you're at home right now, feel free to grab a golf ball, and if you have your putter with you, great. Otherwise, please do this after the video. I guarantee you'll go poo. You won't even believe it. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna grab a ball, and you are going to look at the ball, okay? So you're gonna look at your ball, and you're gonna make a putting stroke. You're gonna look at your ball, you're gonna make a putting stroke, and then I want you to look where the ball was standing. So wherever that ball was sitting, I want you to look where it was, and after you putt the ball, for about 2 to 3 seconds, you're gonna see a black shadow, a black circular shadow that will last 2 to 3 seconds, and then it's gonna disappear, okay? So you're gonna look at your ball. I want you to look where your ball was sitting after you make your stroke, and you'll see a little black shadow for about 2 to 3 seconds, and then it disappears. Now, obviously, it's a bit of an optical illusion, but for me, when I see that black shadow, I wait until I see that black shadow, and then I allow myself to look at the putt, okay? Now, I have the odd person that says they can't see that little black shadow. That's okay. Don't worry about it. I want you to count to two. So when you make your putt, when you go to make your putt, and if you can't see that black shadow, I want you to make your putt and go one, two, and then I want you to look. Okay, so that black shadow to me is awesome. It's really kept me over my putt, not peeking up and not looking early. So really, really important, okay? All right, so those are some really big fundamentals to start off with becoming a really good putter. Now, another thing when we're getting ready for good putting, obviously, is we need to know how to read a green. So we can't even make a putting stroke until we know where are we supposed to putt this ball. Now, obviously, if a putting green is dead flat, there's no break, which means it's a dead straight putt. We want dead straight putts. If you're putting straight uphill, that's gonna be a dead straight putt too, which is great. We love dead straight putts. Little trickier when it's downhill. It could be straight, but it's gonna be quite quick and hard to stop, all right? But when a putting green is dead flat, there's no what we call break, okay? No break. Now, when you're reading a putting green, number one, I think it's really important. A great tip is when you're coming up to the green, I want you to look around the green. So as you're approaching the green, look to where the high side is. You know, look to where to see where the drainage is. Wherever those drainage, you know, you'll see some of those drainage circles on the edges of the green. Well, guess what? Water doesn't drain uphill. So that'll probably be the lower side of the green. So take a peek to see where the drainage is. Take a look at the contours of the green. The next thing is when you're reading a green, I want you to tuck down. You'll see a lot of golfers as they're getting ready for their putt kind of tuck down. I find you can see the contours of the green a lot easier from here. So kind of to tuck down and see that. What I want you to look for is very simply at first, high side, low side. I had the opportunity to do a really cool three-hole match with Steve Elkington, PGA Tour major winner. And it was so cool because I missed a putt on the first hole, and he's like, Lisa, you missed on the am side. And I said, the am side? And he said, yeah, you missed on the low side of the hole. He goes, pros don't miss on the low side of the hole. He said, we miss on the high side of the hole. So here's the thing. First thing I want you to look at when you're looking at your cup, where's the high side of the hole? If it's not dead flat, there's a high side to the cup. And again, you want to putt like a pro, which means don't go below the hole because you didn't even give yourself a chance to go in. So high side of the cup, low side of the cup. That's the first thing you're looking for. Where's the high side? Where's the low side? So again, you want to miss on the pro side, not the am side. Now, Dave Stockton is an incredible, incredible putter. He's a 25-time, I believe, tour winner. He's won 2 majors on the PGA Tour and is known for his excellent putting. I had the opportunity to meet Dave Stockton, such a cool, generous, gracious guy. And a couple tips that he gave me when we were talking is, number one, he said he only looks at the putt from 2 different angles. One, from behind the ball, and he'll tuck down low. One, from behind the ball and low. Then he looks for the low side of the putt. Wherever the low side of the putt is, he says he goes to that side of the green and he double checks, you know, what that angle looks like and how severe the slope is. He said walking around the hole is going to confuse you. It's going to confuse you and give you different reads. So he said look from behind the ball and then go to the low side of the ball, and he said that will show you how much slope there is. So that's a great tip and has really helped me. The second tip, which was really a game changer with Dave Stockton when he helped me. So he said, what you're going to do is you're going to pick a line. So the whole thing with green reading is you want to find what we call the apex of the break. So when you look down, you want to see where, at what point on the green is the high spot that you know then the ball will start traveling down towards the cup. So you always want to putt a straight putt towards the apex of the break and then know that that ball is going to start going towards the hole. So a great way to do that is to actually use the alignment marks on your balls. Every single golf manufacturer, for the most part, has lines on the ball. So you can see here, this ball, there we go. Now that's got a nice big thick line for you. This is another ball here. So this one has a skinnier line. And you can see it even has arrows there. It even has arrows. And sometimes that's hard to see. You've seen that I've recommended before, if you love someone who loves alignment, is you can get a Sharpie and you can purchase this, like this is the Pels Golf. I think it's about $10 at Golf Town. And you can put it on your little ball here, or you can do freehand. It's just, I'm a horrendous drawer. You can put this on. And again, anyone who watched the Masters, I bet you saw so many of the PGA Tour pros in the Masters coverage when they zoomed in on the ball. What did you see? Many of them drew a line on the ball. Why? Because this helps just accentuate that line, helps them line it up to the apex of that break. So if you're someone who likes visual cues, you will love adding a dark black line or whatever color Sharpie that you want to use. So then what you want to do is you want to line that line up to the apex of the break. And luckily, every single putter, for the most part, has some sort of alignment line. So here, oops, it looks like I was giving you the finger. Sorry, I wasn't giving you the finger. I'll switch fingers. this line right here, you can line that up with the line here. So then that's how you can use that alignment tool. Again, you've got, or you can, many people like that two ball, right? So there's the two ball, but if you've got the triple track, you can see there's also alignment lines with the visual two ball line there. And even again, your mallets. So again, all different styles of putters come with that alignment line, and you're to line that up with the line that you've drawn on your ball, and that would be to the apex of the break. Okay, so very, really important. Okay, I see so many people are joining us. Thank you so much. I'm thrilled that you're coming to watch. Linda Tremblay, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Annette, she's giggling, I think, on my finger. Oops, sorry about that, everybody. And I see that Ruby has joined us as well from Timmins, Ontario. Thank you so much. All right, so those are some really key points in getting that alignment right and how to properly read a green. Another great thought to read a green is if you poured a bucket of water again on that green, which way would that water flow? So that would help you again with high side, low side. So really important there. All right, this next tip for me is absolutely a game changer. This absolutely, I won't say eliminated my three putts, but came pretty darn close to eliminating my three putts. So if you're someone that struggles with distance control, you're gonna love this next tip. So this next tip is all about changing how you think about a putt. And this is what I mean by that. So when you're putting, here we go. When you're putting, and you know when you make a putt, let's go this way. You know when you make a putt, and let's say you make a putt, and you've made your putt, and it just blows by the hole. It blows by the hole. And the first thing you say is like, ah, oh, I hit it too hard. So let's say you were to redo that putt. If you were to redo that putt, you're thinking to yourself, well, if I hit that one too hard, I'm just gonna hit this one a little softer. So then you go to hit that next putt or make that stroke to that next putt. And it went short. So now you're thinking to yourself, oh, well, I hit that too soft. Here's the problem. That's not measurable. So again, the more measurable we can be, I think the more successful you're gonna be in golf. So I don't want you to think anymore too hard, too soft. So when you blow a ball past the cup, I don't ever want you to think anymore, oh, I hit it too hard. What I want you to think is I took too long of a stroke. And if you hit it short of the cup, I don't want you to think, oh, I hit it too short, I hit it too soft, you know, oh, I got it caught in my purse. I know some of you out there are saying that sometimes, right? I want you to think to yourself, oh shoot, I made too short of a stroke. If you can start thinking of your putting in length of stroke versus how hard and how soft, I guarantee you will immediately become a better putter. So again, back to measurable, I'm a huge fan of measurable. So when you're golfing, what I want you to do, I want you to have some benchmarks. I want you to have some benchmarks that when you're getting ready to putt, it looks something like this. So one of my benchmarks is inside of my golf shoe to the inside of my golf shoe. My other one might be to my pinky toe to my pinky toe. My other one might be to just past my back shoe to just past my front shoe. So it's so important that you want to make sure that your stroke is at least equal. Again, my coach Paul Horton said one of the biggest mistakes that he sees with putters is that they take a good backswing and then stab at it. So they take that backswing, they take the backswing and stop. And again, there's no distance control. You want to go at least as far forward as you did back. So that's why that measurable, inside a foot to inside a foot, pinky toe to pinky toe, just past your shoe to just past your shoe. And again, let's say you had a putt way across the green. Maybe it's a foot and a half past your shoe to a foot and a half past your shoe. Measurable, something that's measurable. I guarantee you're going to have way less three putts and you're going to hole out a lot more and leave that that ball way closer to the cup so that you can have a tap in without the knee knocker. So again, you always want to be thinking, you want to go at least as far back as you do through. And actually, even if you went a little farther through, that's okay. A little farther through is okay, but you never want to have that stabbing motion. Again, at least as far through as you went back, and it's okay if you went a little bit farther. For me, that was a huge, huge, huge game changer. So huge game changer. Now, another little drill that you can do, especially for our Ontario friends who are stuck still in their basements, and many Canadians who are stuck at home if their golf courses aren't open yet, or just even to practice in the evenings if you don't happen to have a tee time after work, here's a great distance control drill. What I want you to do, you can just grab two balls, do it on your carpet. If you have obviously a non-shag carpet, you want your carpet to be something that would simulate a putting green. And I want you to spread out two balls, okay? You're gonna spread out two balls, and then what I want you to do is I want you to take a couple of balls, and I want you to see how many times you can add a ball with between the two balls, meaning that maybe you'll just get the first one just past the first pink ball, then the next one slightly longer, then slightly longer. So this is a great drill to work on your distance control, okay? So have yourself a mark, and my goal is to get just past this first ball. Okay, nice. I went a little longer. So I got just past there. So now I want this next ball to go slightly further, which means a slightly longer stroke. Not harder, longer. See, now I was too long. On that one, I was too long of a stroke. But this is something you can do at home. This can be a fun game with your family. How cool would that be? So this is instead of just watching Netflix, not that I'm not a fan of Netflix, but this is a great family activity. Instead of a board game, come on down here and do some cool putting challenges or something you can just do on your own while you're practicing it, again, in your basement, your living room, wherever you've got some carpet to roll it. If you do hardwood, now we're talking Augusta National. So that's a great little drill there. Something else we need to do to make sure we have excellent putting, and this sounds so simple, but so many people miss it. When you start your putt, you need to make sure you have a square putter face. People start up often, and square means facing straight at the ball. Often that toe can come in, or so it's kind of what we call closed, or it can open up. So it's really easy for that putter face to shift. So another little drill that you can try is you can get two balls, make them slightly wider than the size of a real ball, and do a few putts. Start at about 2 feet. And see if you can keep that putter face square, if that nice face is nice and square, the ball should be able to roll through the two balls. So again, start with 2 feet. Make sure that putter face is square. Make sure that putter face is square. Make that stroke. Oh, I made it through. So again, and then if you make it through on that one, go back to 3 feet, 4 feet, 5 feet. So there's lots of things you can be doing at home to work on that stroke and on that distance control. So I'm hoping some of these tips have been helpful for you with your putting. I just want to do a shout out. I see Margot from New Brunswick. Thanks so much for joining us, Margot. And Patty, I would love to call sadly, I don't have any connections with your premier, but I signed the petition. I did sign your petition for you, and Susan from Fredericton, New Brunswick. Thanks so much for joining us. So thank you everyone for joining us. I hope that these putting tips are going to be helpful for you, and the pitching tips. If I didn't get a chance to see your comment, I will take time over the next several days. Facebook only allows me to respond to about 150 comments at a time, and then I have to stop for 12 hours, and then they allow me to do another 150. So it takes me several days to respond to everybody, but I will respond to each and every comment. If you've left a comment, I will take time because I appreciate that. Thank you. you for sharing the videos. I know many of you have been sharing them to your own Facebook pages and tagging friends that would enjoy these videos. So please continue to do that. And of course, if you have any questions, you can reach out to me. My Twitter and Instagram is at Lisa Longball. And I have a YouTube page, which is Lisa Longball. And my Facebook page is also Lisa Longball. So, and my website's lisalongball.com. So again, please reach out to me. Happy to answer any questions and any of that as well too. Now, we were going to stop the lessons. Today was going to be our sixth lesson and our last lesson. However, we've had such tremendous feedback that we're going to continue the lessons. And starting in the month of May here, we want to do some women's focus lessons. And that's no offense to the gentlemen out there, please. But we just, there's a lot of ladies that had specific questions that we wanted to focus on. So I'm going to answer a whole bunch of ladies' questions in the month of May. That being said, guys, I promise you're going to learn some things from that as well. Now, the next class, so my May 4th class is going to be about women's golf apparel and golf footwear. So golf apparel and footwear. So that one, for guys, unless you're shopping for Mother's Day, that might be a skipper for you. That might be a skipper for you. But the week afterwards, I'm going to talk about some great tips that I promise can help you. And also, if you golf with a lady in your life, these are some tips that could be very, very helpful for her as well. And then I'll do some course management tips on later in the month, and we're going to talk about equipment as well. So the next four classes are going to be women's focused, but the guys, there's going to be at least two of those classes that are going to be chock full of tips that men or women could use for sure. So again, I can't wait to see you all next week. Thanks so much for all the love out there, and enjoy your week. I hope you guys can all tee it up. Go long. Thanks, everyone.